So they eventually have to announce the price of these new consoles, right?
They already announced it, dude. It's dollars. Isn't that wild?
Oh, I didn't think it would be that low, high. Just use the one.
No, you got to dub it later.
Oh, shit.
And so it sounds like shit. That's so the whole bit.
You think in an industry that is so, like, about prioritizing, like, pre-orders?
I have a theory about that, which is that I think that they don't want a lot of pre-orders because they probably can't make a lot of these things right now.
Yeah, early adapters.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. So they're going to be so fucking expensive and they're just going to be so hard to make that they are not going to make enough of them.
I mean, they're still going to tout that they sold out of the first run of them.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Well, that's why.
We can't keep up with demand.
The wheel of capitalism, it keeps on turning because what's going to happen is...
There's no way that Sony and Microsoft are going to be better at artificial scarcity than Nintendo.
What's going to happen is... You got Corona and the way that affected manufacturing.
Sure.
Because obviously these things are going to be made in China. Mm-hmm. You have, on top of that, the fact that computer components are so competed for these days because cell phones use them, consoles use them, computers use them, laptops use them, fucking microwaves use them, you know. So they have to compete with those. You combine that with the fact that these things are probably coming in pretty hot and they probably just now. It's July, by the way, when this is being recorded.
Yeah.
I know we made our joke, but just now getting to the manufacturing. I think they released like a photo like a week ago of the first PS5 coming off the production line or something. So
it's officially gone gold.
And they beamed it with a Star Trek beam up. They beamed it off of the assembly line into the warehouse.
Eventually, this game of chicken is gonna run out. I mean, do you think by the time that this episode goes up, we'll know? That's only two full months drive people into stores to
Full disclosure for those listening, we're not 100% sure exactly when this episode is gonna come out. But we think around the end of August.
Mid to late August.
So that will be after Gamescom and TGS or whatever the hell replaces Gamescom and TGS.
Right. And that should be.
Are they even going to do a stream for those? Or are they just like, that's the whole thing. It's like in a normal year where the world wasn't completely on fire, I could be like, well, they're probably waiting until TGS to announce it, or they're probably waiting until Gamescom to announce it.
I mean, Microsoft has their thing next week.
I don't think that they'll announce a price. I think that they'll announce the second Xbox, the Lockhart, whatever that's supposed to be, and then still not talk about
Series
price.
S. I guess. I just, like, I don't know. It's just weird. This is very unprecedented.
Yeah.
For more reasons than one, obviously.
All right. This is going to be a wild suggestion. Bear with me. What if they, just priced it based on what it cost to make?
Sony or Microsoft?
Both.
I think Microsoft's going to go the financing route. That's more of a Sony thing.
Well, then why that? Then they might not even announce a price.
Well, I mean, you can't say, hey, this costs $20 a month and not say what it actually, the MSRP or whatever.
Yeah, you can't give a financing option without giving people the option to buy it outright.
Yeah.
Which I'm not... Yeah. I'm already financing a car and a cell phone and fucking medicine or whatever. I'm not financing my fucking...
I will. I can afford... Like, that's the way that I would be able to actually get...
It's a good option.
A new console.
Just saying.
Oh, I'm not saying it's not...
I don't want the bank to own my PlayStation 5, Randy.
They're not going to take it back.
they wouldn't be able to if you tried its automatic turrets.
Yeah. They're gonna repossess my PS5 right when I'm in the middle of playing
Uncharted 5.
We still
don't even know
5.
How much the games are going to get are going to cost. Because,
$60 to $70.
Well, okay, so at this point, can you pre-order that fucking 2K basketball game?
For
$70. And then Ubisoft just had their thing. And now you can pre-order the next generation versions of Far Cry for $60.
Yeah, but do you remember when...
Because the smart delivery thing doesn't make...
Hold on.
Okay.
Do you remember when Perfect Dark Zero and Cameo came out and they were $50?
Were they?
Mm-hmm.
Then why were the games that were available on, like, the
Call of Duty was 60.
The cross-generational games,
we don't,
like,
remember, because plenty of people tried to forget that they paid $50 for Perfect Dark Zero.
It's true. But, like...
What about Cameo?
But I don't care about Cameo either.
What else did Microsoft make?
Well,
Cameo, game most likely for me to scroll past his thumbnail for the rest of eternity.
But those games like American Wasteland and Gun and Peter Jackson's King Kong, those were $50 on PS2, Xbox, and GameCube. Those were $60 on 360.
Oh, maybe Ubisoft just cares about their customers, dude.
Do you think
Peter Jackson's King Kong was dope?
It was kind of dope. I watched this weird analysis about that game the other day.
Of all the games he just named, that's the one to point out. That's awesome.
It was better than the movie.
Was it better than Gun or American Wasteland?
Well,
I honestly, yes.
I had fun with all those games, but I don't know. I mean, do you think gaming, I was talking to you about this the other day, and if the industry is going to go back to just being unregulated in terms of MSRP, like just publishers deciding, it's like, hey, this game's, we're kind of there already with indie stuff.
Is it? I don't think it's regulated now.
Well, I know that at one point Microsoft did...
Make a rule.
Yeah, I think it was a cap.
Yeah, which Sony also followed suit. Well, I don't know if Nintendo did. But, I mean, we talked about it in our Valve episode, but Half-Life 2 is the first modern game that I saw for $60, and that was still just PC.
Yeah, not worth it, right?
I mean, if it makes people feel better, you can
You can buy for $2.99. Should have waited 10 years, idiots.
Absolutely worth it, that game.
Halo 2 was $50.
But you can go back and look at catalogs from the 90s that have N64 games for 80 and
Chrono Trigger is the obvious example Genesis for everybody. Games. It's like $100 or some weird shit.
But then at some point it was like, hey, everything's 50. And then it was like everything's 60.
That's a good thing to look into. I don't actually know if there is a rule for Xbox One and PS4 of whether or not games have to be 60.
I don't know. Well, there isn't a rule because there's been plenty of physical boxes that have come out like on disc that'll be 20, 30, 40, 50, whatever.
No, I know, but like a cap is what I mean.
Oh, a cap.
Like a cap at $59.99.
Well, that gets garbled up with all the special edition shit.
Well, yeah. The special edition shit, the special edition shit is, if they had a cap, that would be how you get around it, right? You just go like, well,
that's
you,
a good
can
point.
Get, you can
here's
get
a- some skins at $70 or 80 or 100 or whatever.
Oh, you mean like Bungie does now.
Yeah. I mean, Ubisoft announced that you can buy like a $70 version of Far Cry that comes with like a gun skin or whatever.
Well, that's why I use 2K, because it's like their pricing structure is already egregious, because that basketball game is going to be littered with microtransactions anyway.
I also realized that Uplay Plus is a thing. Forgot about that. So
wait, is that paid for?
It's like $15 a month, and you get every Ubisoft game.
Do you get like when every time Siege releases new content, do you get that?
I believe. I don't think you do, but
okay.
I don't know. I was just saying, since Assassin's Creed and Watch Dogs and Far Cry are all coming out within like 5 hours of each other, I could just get Uplay Plus.
I mean, you pointed it out also that, like, what's the point in buying a $70 Series X or PS5 game if you could just buy a $60? Like,
well, that's why I think Far Cry costs $60. And I think
because
you can just upgrade.
Upgrade anyway.
And then once they stop making Xbox One versions, that's when smart delivery will stop. Because I think it's a stopgap, and then they'll just they'll just be $70. It'll be like, instead of paying $60 for the Xbox One version and getting the Series X version or for the PS4 version upgrading, it would be $70. And then they would be like, you also can play it on PS4.
I mean, I should point out that me and you, we bought a Call of Duty game. I think it was Ghost was cross-generation. And we paid $70, and that just gave us codes for both.
Because
we played it on 360 for like
the best Call of Duty, some might say.
I was going to say, that game sucked anyway. It was like the worst one to spend $70 on.
It was.
And then, when the Xbox One came out, then we just cashed another code.
Mm-hmm.
But now they have discs that do that anyway, where they're re-releasing like Oblivion and World at War and shit. I don't know. It's
the whole idea, I think, is that at least for Xbox One, PS4, Xbox Series X, PS5, they're all Blu-ray lasers, so it's not like...
It's more expensive to...
You don't have to put two lasers in.
Oh, yeah.
Because like with the PS1 and the PS2 and then the PS2 to the PS3, like with the PS1, they had a special laser that would shine through those black backs.
Mm-hmm.
And then they didn't do that with PS2. They were just DVDs.
Weren't there a couple of PS2 games that had like the blue backs?
They did. But that was nothing. That was just to look cool. And then the PS
it did look cool, to be fair.
And then the and then the PS3 was Blu-ray, so they had to like put the lasers, which is why eventually the PS3 just stopped including PS2 compatibility.
And those discs weren't even blue.
No, they were fucking normal colored bullshit, dude.
Welcome to Hot Button, everybody.
That's a good transition.
I'm Randall Beatrice, and those magnificent voices were Austin Blakeslee. Jason's going to kill you.
Yeah, he is.
And Chris Anantuano.
You introduced us this time.
I did. Well, that episode got lost anyway, so we're going to have to...
Oh, the lost... Yeah, the lost clips.
Yeah, too hot
iTunes. I made a joke that was so funny... that Randy shit himself. And then we lost it because we paused it wrong so he could go clean himself up. That's why we lost it. That's official Hot Button canon now.
I'd like that to... that is. I also discovered the cure for cancer and made $1 billion, but I lost it all.
Instead of writing it down, you just said it on the podcast and then the audio file got corrupt.
So today is going to be an interesting one, a topic that I'm ashamed to say is a little bit of a black mark on my gaming knowledge as a Wii one growing up in the 90s. See, we all remember...
Talking about the Wii?
See, we all remember the Super Nintendo.
Keep saying Wii.
Right? We all remember the N64.
Is that W-I-I all remember the N64?
But you know what we don't tend to remember? The official...
The GameCube.
don't even. That official home console released between then by our big boys at the Big N, the Virtual Boy.
Wasn't it technically a handheld, which is why it was called the Virtual Boy?
No, because it was not portable.
I thought it was.
Nope.
It was marketed to be portable. Yeah, but we'll get
into
that.
Plug it into a wall. The head-mounted, headache-inducing double D-pad featuring red and black monstrosity that even the creators of the Wii U like to pretend didn't happen. It was ambitious. It was audacious. It was expensive. And boy, did it fail. Chris, what exactly led to this thing getting to market? And what about its reception made Nintendo never want to attempt glasses-less 3D again until the DS's successor 15 years later?
And did it have a handle on it? That's one of the important questions.
Why did that one horror first-person shooter that was made for it never come to the United States?
Well, this is more of the story of a man specifically, or a couple of men, and it's more about, obviously it involves technology and money, so of course it's about men sticking their dicks into everything. But, like, this is more about the story of just ambitious people and technology, which is something that comes up all too much in the world of virtual reality in general, which is something we'll get into.
So VR! First,
I have
one of those.
Yeah.
So, picture this. You just got a brand new CyberPower PC Gamer Xtreme with an X VR gaming PC, liquid cool with Windows 10 Home.
I'm closing my eyes. I can see it right now.
You order a Valve Index for $500 on the Steam summer sale, or $1,000 if you missed it.
No.
Is that on sale?
It wasn't on sale. A little fun fact for you. The $500 is just for the headset. The $1,000 comes with Half-Life Alyx and the lighthouses and the controllers.
There you go. So
it comes with a lighthouse?
you have to put up two lighthouses in your room before you can play. That's how accessible it is.
You put your headset on because it's your time. Because Valve canceled 10 other games that everybody actually wanted to play so that you and 17 other people could play Half-Life Alyx. All right. You turn it on. And instead of Half-Life Alyx, it's a red and black monochrome Mario Tennis.
Oh, shit. Is Waluigi there?
And then you wake up.
He didn't exist.
It was all just a bad dream because you don't live in a world where all VR technology stemmed from the creation of Nintendo's Virtual Boy.
It is a great name.
No, it stemmed from the movie The First Kid. You remember they played VR in that movie?
No. What the hell movie is that?
Is Sinbad?
Oh, Good Burger.
No.
So originally, I had planned to do an episode about unionization in the video game industry and a story about crunch. And I was working really hard on it, but then I found myself literally crunching like 2 days before we were supposed to do it. And I was like, I'm not even joking. I was like, I stopped and I was like, what am I fucking doing? Like, the quality is starting to like take a dip. Like, and it was just this massive ironic, like,
well, yeah, I mean, we would have fired him, honestly, if and taken his name doing. Off of the
well, so I messaged y'all and I was like, you know what? I want this to be fucking perfect because it's important to me. It's a good topic. Yeah. So
if the Metacritic score for the episode was under 70, would have got fired. But if it was yes, above 90, we would have given him a bonus.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I decided to switch it up and do probably the most hot buttony hot button episode. It's very just, this is a story of a thing in video games. So it won't be as deep and as political as unions, but it is a pretty interesting story and actually far, far deeper than I thought it would be.
Let's go deep.
Which is, tends to be...
You guys gotta stop saying deep.
Which tends to be the situation in Hot Button.
The Virtual Boy does have a skin on Rob the Robot in the new Smash Brothers, so...
Oh, yes. Yeah. Well, that makes sense.
Yeah, so they made it, really.
Yes.
Fun fact, did you know that the Wii U only sold 17 times more than the Virtual Boy?
Oh, only?
Only.
So first of all, I'd like to give a shout out to a writer, Benj Edwards, who did an incredible, almost book-like story called Unraveling the Enigma of the Virtual Boy 20 years later.
And, that's a great
if you get
name.
A chance, read that article. It's also incredible. And I'd also like to give a shout out to the autobiography of our main character, which we'll get into. A lot of this stuff comes from that as well.
Cool.
All right. Howard Lincoln.
So what is the Virtual Boy?
You just said it's a Valve Index, but 20 years before.
No, besides looking like a charcoal grill from a cyberpunk movie,
that tripod is great.
The Virtual Boy was a 32-bit game console created by Nintendo in 1996 and touted as the first console ever capable of stereoscopic 3D.
Wait, it came out in 96? I thought it was 95. Yeah. Oh, shit.
Oh, yes. Sorry. 95.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Actually, I just read that wrong.
No. Hold on. I just pulled it. It came out in 96 here in North America.
Yeah, in America.
Japanese were lucky enough to get it like in December of 95, right before Christmas.
So, much like the Power Glove and the Wii U, it was a critical success, as we all know.
I'm wearing both my Power Gloves right now.
If the Virtual Boy's success meant looking like a failed prop for the Blade Runner eye test, then it would have actually been successful.
Yeah.
No, it was not received well critically or commercially. And while it's easy to look back now and wonder why the fuck Nintendo would ever release a console that looked like the decapitated head of Rob the Robot's mother on a stand... It's not easy in the moment to see the whole picture.
I just want to
point
out...
That's why he's so angry.
I Googled Virtual Boy and one of the autocompletes was, can the Virtual Boy make you blind? So...
Yes. That will come up quite a bit.
Oh my God. I'm glad I only played it for like 10 minutes.
So, let's take a walk down failed Nintendo design lane and explore how and why this thing came to be. And somewhere around the middle, we're going to pause so we can get a genuine reaction. We're all going to watch one of the ads for the Nintendo Virtual Boy. I haven't watched it. I only saw clips from it in a video, so I watched the whole thing. I wanted to save it so we can all watch it together.
That's a good idea.
All right, so we're going to start way, way back with our main character and an absolute legend of Nintendo and video games as a whole, a man by the name of Yokoi Gunpei, or Goonpei. Well, I think it's Goonpei.
Wait,
Yokoi Goonpei.
Forgive me for jumping ahead a little bit, but wasn't he also on the Game Boy team?
We'll get there.
Okay.
Hired by Nintendo in 1965 as a maintenance man on the assembly line. Typically, he was working on maintaining the machines that made the Hanafuda cards, which, as most people probably know from history, is the cards that Nintendo made for ever. They were a toy company for a long time.
Yeah.
It has to do with like some sort of game. Like you could play a number of different games with them, but it's kind of like these just like
they're
pictured
like
cards.
Japanese playing cards, but they have pictures instead of numbers.
Cool.
Yeah. Okay. And they could be used for a number of things. So they had machines that made those cards because that's what Nintendo did, and he was a maintenance man. Rolled around the plants, fixing things here and there, handyman kind of guy. So one day, when Nintendo president Hiroshi Yamauchi, who we've probably talked about a billion times on the show.
I think both these individuals came up on our Tetris episode.
Yeah. He was visiting the plant. Well, Yokoi worked at this plant, and he noticed something. See, Yokoi made a toy for fun in his spare time. I'll send a picture into the Discord, but I'll try to do my best to describe it as well to our audience.
Let's see.
So, what it is... is it's got two handles and a big zigzag, and you close it.
What did
Wildy
Coyote oil the, order this yeah, to
it,
take
it
out
extends,
Rave Runner?
And it's kind of like a claw. Like picture those old school like claw
oh,
toys where you
I
squeeze
had one
the
of these.
Center. Yeah, and yeah. it pushes it together, and it grabs something on the end, and you open it, and it like retracts it. Well,
it's very they made as seen on TV versions of this for elderly. Folk.
Oh yeah, but absolutely.
Yeah. But yeah, this just totally the color
those
palette
classic
of this thing.
Claws toys, you know, it, but yeah. a more primitive version of that.
It's very Acme Looney Tunes.
It works a lot like garden shears, where like the handles go in, but instead of a blade, yeah. it's like a little claw on yes. the end.
Also, I think I said Raid Runner. I'm Road Runner.
Well,
video games on the mind.
Yamauchi immediately demanded that Yokoi make a proper version of this and have it released as a product for the holiday season for Nintendo. And the Ultra Hand, as this product is called, if you want to Google it, cool. was born, and it was wildly successful. This is the fucking claw toy. This guy invented the claw toy. How insane is that? That just blows my mind. Like, this is like one of like, I've dude, you know how many times I've fucked with claw toys like this in my life? And now I'm finding out this is, here's how it was created.
Is there string on this as well? Like it's,
it does seem to be like you can pull it back or maybe grab something with it. I'm not exactly sure how yeah. it works or what the toy is. It seems to come in like a box with some other stuff with it. So he went on to make a couple of other toys. I think there was like some love-o-meter where he could determine how much a person loved you, and like a few other just like kind of like classical toys.
It's like
from
the love manic machine from like Mars Bar in The Simpsons.
That sounds like a real monkey's paw situation there.
Yeah. He also helped make like a puzzle. I think it's called a 1,000-barrel puzzle or a 100-barrel puzzle. It's like a, it's just like you twist it and shift it. There's like a ball inside that you move around. It's pretty cool.
Just hours of fun, really.
Yeah. So he was a pretty successful toy maker after this, working for Nintendo. Until, as the company legend goes, one day, Yokoi was on the train, and he was on his way to work, and he witnessed a Japanese salaryman playing with the buttons on an LCD calculator out of boredom. And apparently, it all clicked in his head, and this is when he went on to develop... the Game & Watch.
Ooh.
So, hell if you yeah. don't know what the Game & Watch is, which
it's a prototype DS.
It's the proto Game Boy. Yeah. Essentially, the Game & Watch is a single game Game Boy that you would buy.
But it had those dual screens, like, you know?
It absolutely
the clamshell
yeah.
design.
Yeah. Some had dual screens, some were just kind of like one single display. Like, there was a couple different versions
yeah,
of it.
Yeah, you're right.
Around this time, Yokoi is also credited with being the inventor of the D-pad.
Oh, shit.
So... also another pretty big,
yeah,
you know,
I was gonna say,
gigantic leap forward.
I guarantee every single person that is listening to this right now has used a D-pad at some point in their life.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's at least, important. If not for electronics in general, for video games. So he was the second person ever to be on the video games team in Nintendo. There was only one other person, an engineer, and then it came him. He became the head of the famous R&D 1 team at Nintendo.
Yes. Yeah.
And if anybody's ever heard of them, I'm sure you have if you're into the history of Nintendo or any of that stuff. Yokoi went on to produce with that group a number of low-key games. I don't know if you ever heard of them. Mario Bros., Donkey Kong, Metroid. Until years later,
I don't
later,
know. That's a little underground. We might have to kind of get deep. Yeah.
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 Where he eventually went on to join back up with the Game & Watch team, where they developed a little thing called the fucking Game Boy.
Is that what it was called?
It is. The fucking Game Boy by Nintendo.
They also made a lot of those like first-party Game Boy games off the bat, like Mario Land and stuff.
Yeah, my favorite absolutely. Was the fucking Game Boy Advance SP.
That was yeah. Yeah, so very humble beginnings from a assembly line worker messing around with toys to helping create the most iconic handheld toy of all time.
Yeah.
He had a real critical, American dream over there.
Real American dream.
Yeah.
He had a big part to play in the fact that the screen shouldn't be backlit. See, he believed that they should sacrifice the backlight
what?
Because there were other handheld things that had backlights at that time.
Well, now I take it all back. Fuck him.
He decided no backlight in exchange for battery life. The Game Boy had extraordinarily more battery life than any other competition.
That is true.
And that's what helps that's what helps make the Game Boy
successful. If any of you dig out your Game Boys right now, I guarantee if those batteries aren't eroded, this...
I don't know where my Game Boy is, but my Game Gear, I do know where that is, and that lasts a cool 4 hours.
It doesn't?
On only 6 AA batteries. So,
oh, nice.
I don't know what
you got
a
race to
about.
Beat Sonic the Hedgehog real fast there.
Yeah. So let's hop across the pond into America.
Oh, do we have to?
Yeah, let's not.
Yes, unfortunately we do. So in America, in the early 80s, Massachusetts company by the name of Reflection Technology Incorporated. From here on out, since they'll be mentioned 100 billion times, we're going to call them RTI.
Okay.
So Reflection Technology Incorporated, they had an engineer and their CEO whose name was Alan Becker. And he also was wondering one day while in transportation, much like Yokoi. He was in the plane and he was wondering how the hell he can make a small, high-resolution screen for places like airplanes, because he seemed to be flying a lot, and it would have been a good idea for him, and he worked for a company that made things like that.
Interesting. Okay.
Laptop displays at the time were complete fucking garbage. Have you ever seen a laptop from the late 80s or 90s? They're absolute relics of technology.
Yeah.
Obviously, you couldn't fit CRT technology into a small place because it's fucking gigantic and dangerous. And good LCD screens, while around, we're still some years off of being smaller and like an actual option.
Yeah, probably cheap. So, yeah, they were cheap enough.
Yeah. Oh, they were not as cheap.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
But what was cheap at the time were LEDs. So he decided to take these LEDs and develop an LED eyepiece. And it's called a scanned linear array, is what he created. So I'll just say a quote from this, and I looked into it. And I remember I even was talking to Mel. I was like, hey, I want to get this. I understand the words, but my brain's just not grasping the science. So I looked into it a little bit deeper than this. But essentially how it works is it consists of a single line array of LEDs that would optically print a persistent image onto a person's retina by changing the pattern of lights that light up by sweeping across the given area.
Sounds dangerous.
It does sound dangerous, but it's not as dangerous as you think. From what I understand, it seemed to work similar to, like, you know how you see a bar sign of like a guy lifting up a mug and it's just like the LEDs light up in different places, giving the illusion that the image is in motion. I think it's a similar concept to that.
So it's like those shitty like Tiger telematics games when we were kids. Like,
yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So instead of moving the LEDs themselves, which would be like require like a big piece of electronics, he decided to move a mirror that would oscillate back and forth about 50 times a second, and the LEDs would bounce off of that.
Or wait, Tiger Electronics. I'm sorry. Telematics is the Gizmondo. Okay. Sorry. Yeah, yeah.
This is pretty incredible tech. It was pretty interesting, very cool for the time. And he used this tech, and with the company RTI, they built something called the Private Eye, which is an incredible name for this product. It was a 1-inch display that would simulate a 12-inch display from 18 inches away.
Was it both eyes or was it one eye?
It was one eye.
Okay. Huh.
And, of course, because it was the 80s, they envisioned this device to be attached to everyone like those DBZ scanners. They had just all these grand technology things with it. Quote, Neil Golden and Steve Lipsy, who I've never learned who Neil Golden is. It's kind of hard to find LinkedIn for guys who are businessmen to tech companies in the 80s. However, Steve Lipsy was one of the marketing guys there. So Neil Golden and Steve Lipsy worked up sales literature that described scenarios like doctors checking vital signs or MRI scans with the private eye during surgery, and aircraft technicians referencing technical manuals as they lay on their back, hands clutching greasy tools.
Jeez, all right.
So this was clearly some 80s imagination tech, you know?
Yeah.
We got a screen, we made it so you can simulate a big screen in your eye. Like, this is going to be fucking the future. This is some cyberpunk shit for sure. And we're not talking, obviously, about high-resolution displays. We're talking about images that LED could create in this sort of, you know, simplistic manner. So after selling some kits at some trade shows and shopping around at every company imaginable for a few years, the tech wasn't actually getting too much traction, much like everything from this time in this manner. It was very cool to play around with, but it never made it past like people being like, oh, this is cool. All right. Nah, I'm done with it. Yeah,
he apparently like tried to like pawn this off to like Mattel, Hasbro. Wasn't it at some point Sega even?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
That's crazy.
So it never really landed on functional use, but they went to Mattel and they went to also Hasbro. Mattel was actually interested for a little while. They had like back and forths, but they eventually were just like, no, we're not really interested. And we'll get into what Sega's response was in a moment.
Okay. I think didn't Hasbro buy Mattel at some point?
Yes.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah.
Nice. So first we're going to enter the VR craze of the 1990s. If you were around in this time on in tech or television or internet at all, like you just, the fucking ads for VR stuff in the 90s. I actually sent one. I don't know if you guys watched that weird conference thing I sent. With that weird asshole who's like being very mean to an old man about VR. Maybe we can post that somewhere. Everyone from Sega to NASA was working on VR. I'm sure if you remember, NASA had that glove set with the weird, it looked like some shit literally out of Cyberpunk, like a square metal thing that went in front of your face. It was wild. Look it up. Everyone's thinking about all the potential you could have by going into virtual reality worlds and all this cool thing we could do. Even during this time, there was a Stephen King movie called Lawnmower Man that came out.
Yes.
I don't know if you've
seen this. Starring James Bond's own Pierce Brosnan.
Just to give you a little synopsis quote, Dr. Lawrence Angelo works for Virtual Space Industries and runs experiments using psychoactive drugs and virtual reality to enhance the cognitive performance of chimpanzees. So if you want to go from there on how that movie goes.
How do you think that ages, especially the CGI?
Probably not. Turns out Stephen King actually sued to have his name removed from the fucking movie. And he won, and they removed it.
I heard this
on... Because apparently it devolved from his book.
I heard this on a movie podcast not that long ago, so we were getting into an argument, me and you, also with Dave, about that.
Yeah.
About whether or not... Because I think when it came out on VHS, that was... post lawsuit where they had to remove that stuff from it. Yeah, man, that's funny. Yeah,
that's wild. Even if Stephen King doesn't even like your shitty movie, it's not really good because there are some shitty Stephen King movies. So what did the engineers of RTI do? Well, they were like, let's get in on this, obviously.
Oh, of course.
We have some tech that could probably get involved. So what they did was attach a very early head tracking device, which, we all know what that is now. Move your head left, right. It kind of measures your location in space. And they mocked up a game where you were inside of a tank, like, shooting at other tanks. And since it was the 90s in America, it was in the fucking desert shooting at tanks and pyramids and shit because we're horrible.
We've remade that game many times.
Yeah.
I was going to say, why was that an early days, like, showcase?
I mean, when the Gulf War was like right.
Yeah. Like this is almost like peak Gulf War. And they essentially had created one of the most earliest, cheapest, functional VR headset video games at this point. And with relatively little to no press whatsoever and no attention. And it's kind of the same point keeps coming up over and over again. And to me, it's like hilariously ironic is that everybody's opinion on VR games, even in the 80s and 90s, was, oh, this is cool. So anyway.
Oh, like, so like VR now.
Exactly. It's hilarious. Yeah. Like every time there's a craze, it comes up like, holy shit, this is the future of gaming. This is cool. Goodbye. See you in 20 years. No, try again. Yeah,
no, 3D TVs are really going to hit it.
Yeah. All right, so now they moved on to shopping around this new implementation of their tech. They're making a bunch of sales calls, and apparently one of these little tiny snippets I found. Do you guys know who Timothy Leary is?
Sounds familiar.
He's a famous doctor and psychologist who was like super, super into like drug advocacy and psychedelic drugs and expanding the human mind and all that sort of stuff. Right. He even got into it with him about this. And, quote, he was, of course, very interested in anything that would take you to another place, said Lipsy. Leary was impressed by Reflection's far-out virtual reality tank game. It was a drug-free way to expand his consciousness.
What? Is this tank game still out there?
Far out.
Any footage of it? Like...
I'm not sure. Yeah. I looked around a little bit. Maybe it seemed,
how do you get footage of a game that projects into your eye?
It's probably completely lost to time.
Yeah. I'm sure there is somebody like kind of described it as like being like very wireframe like. My picture kind of
like a battle zone.
That Futurama episode where they go into like the Tron kind of stuff. Like I always picture it like that. So with all the other companies still being out, and surprisingly for once, Sega even was out and said it was a bad idea, which at the time, if you know anything, Sega was amazing at denying incredible opportunities.
Yeah, for more on that, listen to our two-parter on
it. Yeah, but for once, they were right on denying this opportunity.
I guess so. Yeah.
It suffered from classic motion sickness VR sort of thing.
Right.
Which I, as like messing around with PSVR a lot lately, there are some games where it's really bad. I've actually never gotten motion sickness once from playing Super Hot, and I think that's because it's low. Like the texture makes it so it's easily, you know, it's easier to be immersed. You know what I mean? Like there's less blurriness, less confusion.
I'm pretty susceptible to motion sickness, and the only VR games that have ever given me that feeling were spaceship games where you're like flipping around. Austin, what game was it we played?
Eve Valkyrie.
That made me sick. Yeah. And
have you messed around? It's by design. Have you played the Iron Man VR demo?
No, I haven't. I didn't even know there was
that. Will give you a little bit of motion sickness in the beginning, but it's fucking amazing. It's honestly the coolest VR game I've ever played in my life. So I do highly recommend it.
Right,
it's very cool to feel like when you're like flying and you get like you use the move controllers to like as if you were steering like the hands and the suit. It's really cool.
I didn't know there was a demo of that. Okay.
So they had one last powerful connection up their sleeve, and they decided to come pitch this technology to Nintendo in Japan, where eventually this tech came across the desk of Yokoi Gunpei.
Right on.
So we're going to talk a little bit about something about Nintendo's philosophy in general, but more specifically, Yokoi's philosophy. They called this, at the time, lateral thinking of withered technology. Now it has its own incredible... It has its own incredible Japanese phrase, and it's one of those classic Japanese things where it's like this amazing phrase that
and
has this giant thing behind it.
It didn't translate the same.
Even
I
lateral
guess.
Thinking of withered technology or lateral thinking with seasoned technology. So both of those things are kind of like a similar thing.
Right.
So basically, the idea is this. Instead of finding crazy new ways to expand and grow and develop cutting-edge technology, take technology that exists today that is out there in big numbers and find ways to make it fun. Now, if that isn't the most fucking Nintendo shit you ever heard in your life, I don't know what
it is. I mean, Reggie has the famous quote, right, where he was saying, like, hey, if it's not fun, then to him, like, that is Nintendo's stance on just what video gaming means.
Absolutely. Well, this is one of the reasons that the...
Which I have some opinions about that, but by and large, I get it. That's what they do. Yeah.
Absolutely. This helped push the development of the Game & Watch, actually, because they thought this... What's going on? Right now, Sharp and Casio are battling for the digital calculator market. And because of that, there were shitloads of liquid crystal displays and semiconductors. So Nintendo was like, what can we do with those? Boom, Game & Watch. They took something that was saturated in the market and used it to make something fun.
You're telling me Texas Instruments wasn't over?
And that sort of philosophy has been carried on in Nintendo for its entire life for better or for worse.
Absolutely. Yeah.
By the way, side note, as somebody who recently got into building guitar pedals, Texas Instrument made all of those semiconductors and LCD.
No shit, really?
They make fucking everything. Like all the little parts of everything you own is made by like one of three companies, and one of them is Texas Instruments.
So to get a little bit into Yokoi himself, at this point in his life, he was kind of in a unique place in his career. His autobiography said that he felt out of place in the industry in the 90s.
Hmm.
This is a man whose heyday was, you know, I mean, granted, Game Boy came out, what, 89, right?
Yes.
So it's kind of like the tail end. So he felt out of place in the mid to later 90s. His personal opinion was that the home console market was turning into some sort of tech arms race for graphic superiority, and it was at the expense of gameplay. And it
there's too many jokes. Just move
that
on.
That's just so emblematic of modern Nintendo. You cannot bring it up.
Well, literally, I'll read you my exact line here. He thought home console market was turning into tech arms race for graphics at the expense of gameplay, and the games were going towards our hardcore fan base instead of a wider, more core audience. Perfect fit for Nintendo.
Yeah.
I don't know. Crysis is coming to the Switch, so.
played. Yeah. We'll see how that goes.
Yeah, we'll see. Has anybody ever actually played Overwatch on the Switch? Does it look like anything? Or The Witcher 3?
I almost thought about buying it just to... I can't imagine the control method. Yeah, the fidelity on those sticks, second to none for a competitive online first-person shooter.
I will say this. I played Fortnite on the Switch.
You said it was worse than playing it on a phone.
Oh, God, yeah. You know when when you watch a YouTube video and your internet isn't doing too hot?
Boy, do I ever.
And everything looks all blocky and pixelated because it's all compressed. That's what Fortnite looks like on the Switch.
How often?
All the time, the whole time you're playing it. Yeah.
Literally the entire time. So he was also feeling disenchanted, which is the craziest thing, by Nintendo's bureaucracy, because Nintendo had become a larger company. And they got a little bit more bureaucratic about the invention process. And he was like, I'm from like the heyday of engineers and build Nintendo up, you know, in the video game world. Like, he wasn't feeling like he had the same freedom as he used to.
Mm. Yeah. I made one of those hats that you pull the string and it claps. And they're just like, fuck off back to the assembly line, nerd. They kick him.
He had planned on retiring at 50. He made an announcement. I'm going to retire at 50. I'm going to move on for Nintendo. I'm going to make my own company so I can have more control over the invention process. Cool. Not uncommon for toys engineers or video game engineers or engineers in general in this sort of industry. So he was 49 at the time that the private eye technology came across his desk. And he was like, oh, shit. This could be a way for Nintendo to do something new and fun. He thought that this could bolster Nintendo's rep as innovators. You know, they had been innovators for years and years and years.
Yeah.
And he's like, hey, this could be something potentially new. We could revolutionize gaming again. And honestly, it'd be kind of a difficult thing to copy because everybody was out there trying to make this sort of VR tech. And he was like, we have a nice line on this. Everybody else seems to be denying it. Let's do something here. He saw the potential in this VR gaming that literally everybody has since the birth of VR gaming.
Yeah.
He got swept up in the idea that this is the future. This can be something unique. This can be something special, something beyond just a gimmick. Or if it even was a gimmick, it could be a fun gimmick because that's kind of Nintendo's shtick.
Yeah, that's their MO. Yeah.
So the deal just needed to get approved by the Nintendo board. Steve Lipsy came over to Japan, and they gave their usual demonstration with slideshows and all sorts of stuff.
Were there graphs there?
Oh, absolutely. By the end of the meeting, Lipsy said he heard a thud on the table and then saw Nintendo chairman Hiroshi Yamauchi, quote, his head fell on his hand on the table and he was sound asleep. Everybody else was just sitting there, nobody doing anything.
Oh my God.
So they finished the meeting. Lipsy's pissed. He's there with a guy named Jack Plimpton, who was a liaison between American companies and Japanese companies. So he was like a translator and kind of set up the meeting and everything.
Mm. Right.
And he's like, oh, I wasted a fucking trip to Japan. Thanks a lot, dickhead. Mm. And then they're like, no, that was amazing. Quote, in Japanese business, that was the senior guy sending a message to his underlings that they could proceed. They didn't need for him to be involved anymore. The project is a go.
Is that what that means?
I spent about an hour and a half trying to look into this. So it is apparently a thing for senior members of Japanese companies to sleep at meetings. It's almost like a respect flex.
Get the fuck out of here. Okay, it's like a trust thing of just like...
Yeah, well, not even just a trust thing, but like I said, it's like I've read over and over that if you usually see somebody sleeping in a meeting at like from a Japanese company, it's usually the most senior official there. Like, it's just like...
Man, that's a culture shock when you think of how that would be seen here, yeah.
Absolutely. And I've heard that before. That's not the first time I've heard that. That's why I was like, I gotta look into this. Like, what the fuck is with this?
Huh.
So, Nintendo approves, and they're about to make their first big stake into the Virtual Boy. They pay advance royalties to RTI of $10 million, and they buy a stake in RTI themselves.
Hmm.
So RTI, a small Boston tech company, goes, holy shit, we just signed a deal with Nintendo. RTI thought, fuck, this is our chance to make it big. Like, we're going to have tech in a Nintendo video game console.
Yeah.
Like, that's kind of a big deal, especially at this time when Nintendo was throwing out, you know, incredible consoles left and right. Game Boy, Famicom, Super Famicom, all this stuff. So?
Yeah, they're on top of the world at this point. Yeah.
Oh, abso-fucking-lutely.
Yeah.
RTI staffed up and they started working on new projects, like namely one that I found called FaxView, which is a tiny device.
Hell yeah. Is that like that thing in Back to the Future 2?
You talking about a viewfinder? What do you...
And Back to the Future 2, when he goes, "You're fired," and then the fax machine prints out a thing that says, "You're fired."
But no, this is like a tiny black like box that has a 1-inch display, and you receive faxes to it, and then you just look into it, like kind of like
like a viewfinder.
Like a viewfinder. You hold it up to your eye, and you can view the faxes.
that one's the one that says you're fired.
If that's not a product of its fucking time, I don't know what is.
Holy shit!
Right.
So Jesus.
Ugh. Look up pictures of the fax view because there's like ads and shit. I'll send you one if you can't find it.
I was going to say, hold on, I'm on it right now.
Oh, I spelled fax wrong.
You think it would be fax with an X?
Yeah, but I spelled it with a C.
I'm only getting ads for Microsoft Office.
Oh, there it is.
Wait, let me see.
Yeah, it looks like a fucking beeper.
Yeah, it looks like a little black, like oval-shaped device.
Can you imagine just being a businessman on the street, and you're like, oh, hold on.
Hold on, I got a fax.
And
you pull out your pouch that's carrying, like, a holster, like a beeper, and a fax view.
Fuck.
Well, the development of the project begins under the code name VR32.
Oh, and for bit.
Right? For the workers at RTI, they were participating in designing the screens with a subcontracted Japanese company, and they were told to call it the Dragon Project, which seems a little racist to me, to be honest. But, you know, we'll just leave it.
Very racist, actually, I think.
Yokoi was excited. And, of course, his first intention was to implement this awesome-ass head-tracking software that RTI had used in their tank demo.
Yeah.
His goal was to design a pair of goggles that you could put on and walk around with and play a game. So, of course, who wouldn't want that?
I was going to say, they wanted it to be portable at this point. Like, yeah.
But there were difficulties with that from the get-go. Couple things. Number one. The engineers were worried about the proximity of the chips to the user's head, because at the time, there actually weren't many tests about how EMF radiation generated by those high radio emissions in those chips would affect your brain. I mean, it's even still up for debate today about what cell phones do to your head if you hold them next to them, you know? So, like, at the time, they were like, we don't know if we should put these chips next to people's brains.
We're all dead.
So, that fact meant that they had to put a small metal plate between the CPU and where the user's head would be, and this made it way too heavy to wear.
Dispel the cancer rays or whatever.
Yeah,
they put a lead plate in instead.
They also had to put the plates in because the chips were actually causing interference in the visual displays as well.
It's like a 55-pound cell phone. Just yeah.
Even if they didn't cause EMF radiation, they'd have to keep the plates in regardless. So it was too heavy to wear. Like, they just couldn't do it. So they scrapped that idea already, and they moved on with a newly designed, quote, a clumsy shoulder stand design, which I can only imagine looking like some sort of 1800s steampunk, like, diving device.
Yeah, just like the Mad Max thing. Like,
I imagine it looking like, you know that thing where, like, when people break their neck and they put them in that thing
with all the rods on it.
Thank fuck you said that. Because I'm trying to, when I was writing this, I was like, what can I imagine this looking like?
Yeah.
I first thought, like, you know, like this, not a stinger, I think it's like a something missile from Call of Duty. It's like, it looks like it's got the big foam box in it and the missiles hit down from the top.
The
from
javelin?
Modern Warfare? Javelin.
Yeah, yes. The javelin.
I picture it looking like a javelin launcher, like you hold it up.
Now they call it the Joker. It confuses me.
Yeah. So this didn't fly with Nintendo either.
No.
Because the legal department just kept imagining kids falling down the steps while playing this. Which I couldn't stop laughing. I know it's fucked up.
Your kid fell down the stairs. Also, he has cancer.
Jesus Christ.
You know, the metal plate that was supposed to protect his head popped out and stabbed him.
Yeah, well, they're not too far off from what some of the people at Nintendo are imagining, because one of the engineers at RTI, Ben Wells, said there was a scenario where the Nintendo legal department imagined a child playing with the VR32 when the car gets into a car accident.
Oh my God.
And this was one of the, I know! And he was like, that's horrible!
That's the thing they thought about?
Yeah, but that's Nintendo. They don't want that shit happening.
Sure.
So all of this resulted in what you see in the final product. So I know we're already 50 minutes in, but for the first time, let's describe what the Virtual Boy actually looks
like.
Yeah,
like the desktop thing.
You need
to
Google a picture of it to really understand, because it's hard to describe. I think I literally said it best in the beginning. It looks like a charcoal grill from a cyberpunk movie. It really does. It's an eyepiece that kind of looks like Rob the Robot's head, and you would sit it on your desk, and the controller plugged into it, and the power to the wall actually came through the controller.
Yes.
But it was also battery operated too. You could put batteries in the controller.
Oh, shit.
That's where the power came from.
Okay, I didn't know that. Maybe there is some more portability than I thought.
And you would lean into it. That's how you would play. You would lean into it, like looking into it.
It was
playing
on this weird little funky kind of stand.
Like, it's like a tripod.
Is it a tripod or bipod? I think I said tripod.
I think it's a tripod, but I can't think of anything that like normal people would use. It looks like the stands for like lights that you use for film, or like a tripod for a camera. Or like a mic stand.
It almost looks like that attached to one of those like things you put a quarter in and look over the Grand Canyon on. But except it looked like, you said, it looks like Rob the Robot's head, like a viewfinder on stilts.
It looks like a viewfinder on a tripod.
Yeah.
With a controller. Like a weird fucked up controller.
Yeah. A controller, like
I like this controller.
It's kind of cool, but it does have two D-pads and no joystick, which is very weird.
It does. Apparently a bunch of people like saying, like, this is a super comfy controller. Like, I can see it. It actually looks like it would be. Like, it's really long.
The handles almost look like the GameCube kind of design.
Oh, then you know it's bad.
Fuck
you. Yeah. Well, unfortunately, this design was actually like 100% more stationary than they had ever imagined.
Yeah.
And it couldn't even benefit from a better chipset now, because you're thinking, oh, fuck it, it's on the table. Now we can put a better chipset in. We can give it graphics similar to the N64. That's right. This is not the fucking some weird 80s Nintendo gimmick. Right now, while this is being made, the N64 is in development.
Yeah, and they're putting everything into that, because there's no box for this, like you mentioned. It's literally like it's all built into the headset.
It's all built into it. You plug the games into the red part that you look into.
Yeah.
Yeah. So basically what happened, that Nintendo was so invested in the infrastructure of the chips, they had even built a new factory in China to assemble the Virtual Boy. And on top of that,
you know, the country that couldn't even buy the console once it was out.
Yeah. And on top of that, they couldn't add a new chipset because they had invested in building these, like, a specific kind of silicon chip, but it was all embedded hardware and it was battery powered, which I had to look up what embedded hardware means. If you don't know, if you're an idiot like me, it just means all the fancy parts are on one board instead of being separate boards. Mm-hmm. I guess it saves space and makes things more condensed. Mm-hmm. And the machine was also battery powered. And all of this resulted in the fact that the console was far too weak to produce anything aside from layers of 2D sprites
that would
and
flicker.
Basic wireframe environments.
Yeah, that monochrome, like every game had to follow that.
Yeah, like, I haven't described that yet. The fact that this console, if you don't know what a Virtual Boy game looks like, you know how the Game Boy was like greenish and black, and that was how it was, monochrome, greenish and
imagine
black.
Imagine that, but red.
But bright red.
It's harsh red. Like,
it's jarring.
Yeah.
And it's bizarre, because when we think of video games in low-res content, we think of black and white. We think of that pale green with the black and white.
Yeah.
You don't think of bright fucking red and black, but the reason they chose red and black is because apparently with red and black, you could have a really deep darkness, and it involved something about with the LEDs too. You could get a much crisper image with the red. So it resulted in much higher quality images, but it also resulted in the whole thing being fucking red and black. So
did that drive up price? Like, I mean, like, I'm curious.
No, it actually drove down price.
Down price. Okay.
Yeah.
It's just funny because I like, yeah, it just, you can, people have captured footage from those now. Man, just... like,
It's rough. It looks like shit. It does not look like the console is about to come out in 1995, that's for sure. It looks like it came out in 1979.
It really, that's a good way to describe it. I mean, I wonder, if was that also, would that like hurt your eyes less than...
Well, we'll get to how it actually affected your eyes in a minute. So as I described earlier, Yokoi had distaste for Nintendo's development process.
I just want to know if there's another version of this that just instantaneously makes you go blind. Like,
oh, this is cool. Oh, fuck. Like you're looking at an Elder Scroll or something. So Nintendo's development process wasn't really helping Yokoi's disenchantment with their development process.
Yeah, I guess not.
Regardless of the validity of the legal department's concerns, he was still having doubts about how this was going to turn out. And at this point, he wasn't alone. The further and further along the VR32 went in development, the more people were like, wait, what the fuck is going on here? With concern in Japan, the story was much different back across the pond. Back in America, they were still feeling confident. Last thing that RTI had heard was that marketing landed on a name, the Virtual Boy, as in virtual reality, and boy, as in Game Boy.
They're playing
as in they're
the
trying
Game
to
Boy
compare
now,
it to the fucking Game Boy.
Well, because it was like I said, it was supposed to be portable.
Yeah.
This was also the fact, apparently there was a comment tossed around that this was supposed to be Nintendo's fourth product. You know, Famicom, Game Boy, Super Famicom, Virtual Boy. The American...
In retrospect, this is...
Naming it the Virtual Boy gave it this gigantic shadow it had to escape in marketing. Because everybody's like, oh, you know, like the Game Boy, right? Yeah, the Virtual Boy. That's fucking cool. Well, my RTI was still getting all excited and going, holy shit, this is awesome. We got tech and this cool new, this is going to be Nintendo's biggest seller yet. Back in Japan, they were like, this is going to be fucked up, dude. We don't know what the fuck is going on. And
meanwhile,
also,
the N64 is like getting ready. Yeah.
Yeah. And in Japan, they were also waiting on official results on whether or not the display created by RTI was actually harmful to your vision.
Oh, details, details.
So Nintendo hired a doctor from the Shepin's Eye Research Institute in Boston. RTI was in Massachusetts, so they were like, we'll just hire a guy in Boston. They hired a doctor by the name of Eli Pelli.
Yeah,
or Pelli,
when
I'm
he
not
gets
sure.
the when he gets the results, he doesn't have to send them a fax view or whatever. He can just walk down.
And a bunch of people in a Nintendo boardroom all just like staring into a telescope looking beeper thing.
Yeah, and then the update says, oh, it makes you go blind. Like,
and then they're like, fuck, it's in this too. And then they throw
and
it out the window.
Away, they're all blind. Yeah.
Yeah, they're all pirates at that point.
So he couldn't share the official results publicly because of an NDA with Nintendo.
Sure.
But from what did come out, it was determined that the tech was essentially harmless to your eyesight.
Okay.
With one exception.
Oh.
Apparently, children with optic systems that were still in development, which is usually around 5 to 7 years old, could, quote, develop a lazy eye if the two displays were misaligned vertically.
Oh.
Yeah,
I wonder if they ran through similar stuff with the 3DS.
No, like, the 3DS did. That's why the 2DS came out, because you weren't allowed to play it if you were under 7 years old.
I think there was a splash screen that says that when you boot up the 3DS.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay.
Yep.
And that'll also come from something I'm about to mention now. So because of that they couldn't risk the mirrors being misaligned vertically, Nintendo encased them in hard plastic and then a steel frame.
Oh yeah. Don't fuck with this. Yeah.
But to err on the safe side and to be in compliance with a brand new law in Japan called the Product Liability Act, all companies are responsible for all accidents caused by the use of their products.
Mm.
Which
that'd be dope if America
had
that.
Oh, it'd be nice, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
It'd be nice, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
As a result, Japanese companies have to fill their products with manuals. Apparently, there was an example of somebody having a manual for a microwave that said you can't dry your cat in the microwave.
Jesus.
Because they have to like fill it with almost every possible scenario they can think of. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, somebody had to have...
I'm pretty sure that law is probably the reason why the Wii has all those warnings before every game.
Yeah. Yeah.
Small price to pay for fucking liability for companies, you know?
Yeah.
So, Nintendo, still included, to err on the safe side, as I said, a packet that came with it that included several warnings and warnings all over the packaging.
That I'm sure everybody looked at, you know.
Yeah. And the manual was basically a huge book of do nots. And it all stated that kids under 7 shouldn't use it.
Okay.
So that's where probably where that
don't put it in the microwave.
DS goes.
I mean, it's funny that Nintendo would do this multiple times throughout their history of releasing products, because they've always kind of had the initiative to be like, hey, we want this to have the widest appeal possible. Like,
precisely, which is interesting that they cut out under 7, because it's kind of like...
That's a big bulk of market for Nintendo. Their demographic. Yeah.
They also included automatic warnings that were built in on a timer that would tell the user to rest their eyes every 15 minutes.
I think
kind of like how the Wii would tell you to go outside or something.
You know, because it's such a physical activity. Like,
well,
fucking waggle your
wrist. I know
wrist.
It sounds like we're back in the 80s, but time to remind you again that the Saturn and the PS1 were released in the early 90s, and the N64 was not expected to release until 96. So the Virtual Boy began to feel some pressure from the higher-ups in Nintendo. Mm. It was more obvious than ever that the Virtual Boy would never stand up to the Famicom or the Game Boy's success.
Mm.
But the marketing department was now seeing it as, hey, maybe we can use this to fill a market gap until the N64 is released.
Okay.
So this provided even more pressure to launch. And this obviously caused a bunch of tension and stress in the development team. And on top of that, Yokoi was now told to, quote, de-emphasize Mario on the system, as the character was slated to make his big 3D debut on the Ultra 64.
Right. At first, I mean, there were some Mario games on that. I mean, like the tennis and stuff.
Eventually, but, yes.
Yeah.
Quote, at first, I had a large list of titles like Mario Clash, which is a Virtual Boy game, but I was told not to release that kind of stuff. I guess it was an issue of disagreement on how to present the product. For me, it was the perfect game for our target users. But within the company, a lot of people strongly felt that the Virtual Boy would only appeal to a certain crowd of diehard players.
That's so funny. They're like, yeah,
even
no,
Nintendo
every game
is saying,
is gonna
don't
look
put Mario
like,
in it.
Yeah, no, every game is going to look like Star Fox covered in blood. Like, it's just like, what?
So, obviously, this happens in business, but this is the first kind of big blow, besides the fact that the tech is kind of, you know, gimmicky and very cheap. The next big blow is that even Nintendo was like, all right, rush it out. We're going to use it to fill a market gap. It's just a general toy.
Don't put Mario on it.
So this left the team with concepts that they had to develop internally. But they also had a subcontractor to work with called Intelligent Systems, who you might know that they helped design the OG Metroid.
Yeah.
That's the Advanced Wars Fire Emblem. Fire Emblem people, yeah.
Project Steam.
Yeah.
So yeah, they originated as a subcontractor for R&D 1, and they helped work on Metroid and some other.
Their name makes a lot more sense in that, knowing that.
Now that I know they worked on the Virtual Boy, the name Intelligent Systems makes
a lot
of
sense. Oh, I didn't
mean
that. I more meant like the...
I know what you meant.
The way that reads.
It's an ironic name. I get it.
Yeah.
So they ended up making the first Virtual Boy game called Space Pinball, which like you can look up pictures of.
Like the Microsoft game?
Space Pinball became the showcase game at trade shows.
That's what they
and
got, huh? Right.
As soon as this came out, this made RTI incredibly nervous. They were like, wait, this is what you... like? Wait, what? Virtual Boy fourth console? Wait, what? Now you have Space Pinball and wireframe red.
Meanwhile, you see what's on the PlayStation and the N64. Yeah.
Apparently, one of the engineers was like, yeah, I put on the headset and it was cool to play for a moment, but then I was like, all right, back to work. Like, he was like, this was nothing like the tank game we created. Like, we wanted something like that. Oh, like, what is this? So, that nervous and cautious mentality carried over to the public as well. The Virtual Boy was first shown in Japan on November 15th, 94, at Shoshinkai Software Exhibition. And you could play Space Pinball, and they had a Telero Boxer, which was another game they had out for it.
All the greatest hits.
And 2 months later, it was shown at Winter CES, and the reactions at both were pretty similar. there was confusion over the shape and design, the fact that it was a table-mounted device that you leaned into. People were like, oh, shit, this is pretty cool. Stereoscopic 3D is very cool. Oh, that's cool.
Chris, you know? I keep thinking about what you said, where it's like, if seeing this at a tech show in the late 70s or early 80s, people would have fucking lost their minds.
Yes,
it's just
absolutely.
Like the mid-90s. Like, what the hell is this?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. It's like almost like people are looking at it like, oh, this is cool. I like the stereoscopic 3D. Like, it's almost like it's cool. Like, it's almost like seeing a horse on the side of the road. You're like, oh, sick, a horse. Yeah, anyway, where do you want to get drunk? Like, it's not, no, like, they're not, like, people aren't really grasping it. And yeah. Most people are confused by the all red display. They're like, all right, but what's with that red? Like,
yeah. That's.
So the issue was really that nobody in the major media really had anything good or bad to say about it. They kind of didn't say anything at all about it. A lot of the smaller internet forum groups were pretty enraged. They were like, what the fuck is this? But
And it's bold. Like, it has Nintendo's name on it. Like,
absolutely. You could tell the more hardcore, like, game kind of critics and fans of the time who were in smaller communities were like, kind of seeing the writing on the wall with this, but nobody else really cared about it because, of course, this is 94. What is this? PlayStation 1 and all that era. So there's a lot of bigger stuff and games happening.
Totally.
But there was a little bit of renewed confidence in RTI. Alan Becker, the owner of RTI, they shared space with Nintendo at CES that year, and Nintendo publicly announced that they had a partnership with RTI. So he's like, oh, this is pretty cool. Like, once again, I'm feeling a renewed sense of seriousness about this. All right, so let's pause for a second and watch this.
Okay,
ad.
I'm ready.
Okay, I want to bring it up on the computer.
I kind of, oh my God, all right, I'm just going to, I already can tell this is going to be great, so I'm just going to play it into the mic.
It came from the third dimension with its own brain.
Oh my God, what's voice. The Predator vision? Is it taking over
it's
the world?
Legs.
It's got like fucking legs.
What? This like short circuit.
It needs your eyes. Virtual Boy, see it now in 3D.
Play it loud. That was their tag. Okay, so I assume it kills you. Is that what the ad was trying to tell me?
So for people who haven't watched it, which I suggest just Googling Virtual Boy ad and watching the 30-second one, it appears that the Virtual Boy stands up and has some sort of big mechanical legs in some weird post-apocalyptic wasteland.
Yeah, looks
and
like
shoots people.
Yeah, in the setting of like when the first couple Terminator movies show you what the...
Yeah, it looks like that. And then it sucks some sort of wildling person in with its controller cord and forces them to look at VR. So if you saw that fucking ad, you can only imagine what the gameplay would look like. Would you picture it being red wireframe Mario Tennis?
I noticed in this short circuit AT-ST fucking ad that there's no gameplay in that commercial whatsoever. They're not leaning into that.
You can't show what gameplay looks like with stereoscopic 3D.
Oh, good point. How do they capture any of
commercial?
That yeah.
So how do they market it? This ad is the most clear example that Nintendo had no fucking idea
what
how
to
market
do.
This thing.
Yeah.
They geared it towards older players instead of a classic younger base, which they should have because all the games looked like six-year-olds would play them.
And if you're young, it'll give you a lazy eye. Or
and on top of that, they said that it was the evolution of gaming and VR is the future. They focused on the system being virtual reality and talked about the tech instead of showing or focusing on any of the games.
That's the funny thing. Like the use of the word virtual reality, it's like when I was young, that was like compared to like how that phrase is used now. You know, it's just, I don't know, yeah. It's just, it's like none of this is actually VR. I mean,
no, it's not, and that's why, like, people are upset about it.
Yeah.
Your reality's not what, red wireframe?
Is that what you see?
That's what I see everything in.
He's like the worst version of the Matrix 1. Like, that's what Allison sees.
It has all the green tint on.
So, this trouble with marketing and this weird sort of idea to go like, yeah, it's VR, just even gave more trouble. Then there was a big hit as it was coming up to its release. The media in Japan decided to run with a sensationalized story about how it could affect your eyesight poorly. They talked about how all these eyesight warnings and all of these can't play it under 7 was going to damage its users' eyes, and that nobody should play it, or they should reserve caution. Apparently, yeah. I looked into this, like, the article I was reading said that Japan had a bit of a negative connotation towards games in the mid-90s. I couldn't find anything that said that for sure, but I don't know enough about gaming in Japan in the 90s to know if that's true or not.
Like, we were fighting the violence war in this era, but, like, with them, was it more of an addiction thing or a productivity thing?
I have no idea. Yeah, like I'd be interested in looking into that a little bit more. It seemed like it could be a cool thread to pull.
It's like rock music in the 50s.
Maybe.
Yeah.
It's created by the devil.
I mean, this thing looks like the devil.
Make all the kids have drugs and sex. It is the devil. It killed that lady. You saw the ad.
Yeah.
Oh, it did. Yeah, it threw her off a cliff, right? So, on July 21st, I actually just have 2 ST, so I'm assuming it's the 21st. I guess I missed a 1 here in my script. On July 21st, 95, the Virtual Boy was released in Japan. And unlike its boy brothers before it, there were no excited crowds, no lines in the street. Nobody coming to say, huzzah, give me a Virtual Boy.
I'd like to point out that I was fucking 2 years old, maybe, or 1 year. Like, my dad took me and my brother to, like, a midnight lunch for the Super Nintendo at, like, a Toys R Us.
And, oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, and I don't know if that was happening this go around.
No, there were no midnight releases at Toys R Us for the Virtual Boy.
Those lines were not, there were no tents on the sidewalk for this thing.
In America, 1 month later, surprisingly, they didn't sensationalize anything in the media, which is shocking for once. It was released again.
Okay.
And over here,
so it was 95,
It was initially looking okay.
All right.
It had $179.95 was how much it costs.
Okay, that says roughly $300 by...
Yeah.
That says as of 2018. But
it even initially outsold the Saturn. But if you remember from our Sega episodes, the Saturn in America, outselling that wasn't exactly a huge feat in the American market.
Considering how they fucking launched that thing early. Yeah. It's the
Nintendo
weirdest release ever.
Even partnered with Blockbuster to rent out Virtual Boys for $30 a pop, and then would give you a $10 coupon off the console when you returned it.
Fun
Just stick
story.
Your eyes right in there.
That's how I know the Virtual Boy exists.
Was Blockbuster?
Because I saw one in Blockbuster, and I was like, that's cool, let's rent it. And my dad was like, no, we're going to rent...
Your eyeballs will fall out.
We're going to rent, like, Speed or something.
Yeah, that'll turn you into a man.
Yeah.
Classic Austin crying while watching Speed instead of playing Virtual Boy.
Yep.
Can't look at Keanu Reeves to this day.
Yeah, Speed is dope.
Yeah, no, Speed is incredible.
Speed 2 is better.
No, it is not! Are you out of your mind?
Wow. I'll usually side with you in an effort to make Randy angry, but I'm drawing the line.
I played one of these at a... It must have been an EB Games for like a few minutes when I was...
At a what?
I've never touched one or seen one in my life. I texted my brother because he's about 10 years older than me, and I asked him if he had any experience with it. And he said he remembers them at Blockbuster, but there wasn't really too many around, and nobody we knew would pay $300 essentially for one.
I never knew anyone that owned one. Yeah.
So part of the reason they were renting them out is because it was kind of difficult to grasp what you were getting into without experiencing it, as we saw by that horrible fucking ad that makes no sense.
I mean, it's a good strategy to get people to try it. Like, that's
however,
the problem VR is facing now. Like,
this ultimately ended up hurting Nintendo in the long run.
Oh,
because
yeah,
most people rented it and then saw what it was and then realized it wasn't worth fucking $179.
Yeah, returned it early with a migraine and went, no thanks. Yeah.
In Japan, by December of the same year it came out, that's just barely 6 months after its release, Nintendo shut it down. They axed the Virtual Boy.
Oh, gee. Holy
Almost,
shit.
Almost about 6 months after its release. Ugh. It sold 140,000 units in Japan. Now,
that's rough.
That's a lot of stuff. Pretty good for anybody else, but not for Game Boy. Not for... multi-million unit
Famicoms.
Yeah,
when you looked at how the Famicom, both the Famicom systems were doing over there, like, ugh.
Yeah, how many copies did the Game Boy sell? 800,000?
The Game Boy? It's like 50-something million. Yeah.
I think it might be like 80 million or something.
It's a lot.
Yeah. Also, Randall, I think that's what we were confused about in the beginning. It was shut down in 96, okay. That same year.
Had to be prior to the N64, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, they didn't want to cannibalize their own sales.
Yeah.
They don't want people going to the store with, like, the cats up ketchup thing and being like, Virtual Boy N64? Ocarina of Time or Space Pinball?
Which one? Yeah. Yeah, there's some guy who hates video games with a Virtual Boy in his attic right now because he made the wrong choice in 97.
Hey, they both had a Tetris on it.
Yeah, did you ever play Tetris? Virtual
and
Boy
Wario
Tetris?
World. Wario World's the best game on the Virtual Boy.
I like how they reused that name again for a later Wario game, thinking no one would know.
Well, this is from the man who wrote Yokoi's biography. Quote, "What he really regretted was the fact that he hadn't managed to develop a new, completely different type of video game. Yokoi blamed the failure on various factors, from unfair press coverage to misunderstandings to hardcore video game players, and foremost, he blamed Nintendo in Japan for not doing enough to market the system there.
I mean, they never seemed fully behind it, like, to begin with.
They weren't, yeah. Which is interesting because it wasn't like they weren't interested at all, because they put millions of dollars into research and development.
Yeah, right.
Building factories, buying royalties. They put a lot of money into it. Quote from him again, "Give me 1 billion yen to market it, and I would have launched the Virtual Boy into the stratosphere." That's about $10 million.
That's a little, I don't know.
It's a little presumptuous. Yeah. I don't think so. So, in America, where it was doing marginally better, they actually kept it going. They dropped the price from $179 to $159 in October, but then by May of 1996, they dropped it to $100. Oof. And then soon, there was no mention of the Virtual Boy ever again. They officially shut it down in America in August of 96, right after E3 96.
It's funny because now it's worth way more than that.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, now it's worth like what, like $300?
I don't know. I'm going to look it up.
So just barely a year after its launch, you could find the Virtual Boy in the clearance section of toy stores for like $30.
Man.
It barely made it 6 months in Japan, barely a year in America.
This is not actually as expensive as I thought it would be. Like, a Rob the Robot costs more than that. It's like around $200 to get like a refurbished one.
Yo, you want to go halvesies?
Yeah, get a Virtual Boy.
Yeah.
Actually, some of these are selling for like $175.
All right, we're getting a Virtual Boy.
Yeah.
Official. We're going to post a YouTube video of us playing.
Yeah, but
here's
the problem. The games are way more expensive. These games are like, cost more than the, well, some of them are cheap. Tetris is expensive, which is all I care about.
Sidebar, Virtual Boy be a good prop for a video set.
It really would be. Mm-hmm. I bet it might be cheaper to get a broken one. Wow, yeah, some of these like $150. Yeah. Well, I should stop looking at those.
So for Nintendo, this was a loss. But even with the factory built and the development and the marketing and all that, a company the size of Nintendo could just eat that shit up. After all, the N64 was about to be released in September of 96, so they were well on their way to making up for their losses.
Yeah, I mean, they've done that before when you look at stuff with the Wii U. It's like, they can recover.
Wait, the Wii U was a failure?
Austin, I hate to break it to you, but
I do not recall that.
I still play mine every day. I even bought I bought a backpack. I put it in there. It's like a portable system.
Well,
I wish they would just make a portable system like the Wii U, but they're never going
to
do that.
But
so.
You had to lean into it and put it on a table.
Yeah.
But for Alan Becker and RTI, this wasn't just something they could eat. This was an absolutely devastating loss. They had bet the future of their company off of building a relationship with Nintendo and the success of the Virtual Boy. And their FaxView product, surprise, it never really took off. And after a few years of researching new technology and working on a color version of the private eye display, RTI ran out of funding and closed down just a couple years after.
Shame.
Yeah.
Yeah, Nintendo's all right. They walk away, but it kind of fucked these guys over.
Yeah.
As for Yokoi, quote, "When it failed, he," meaning Yamauchi, "just withdrew the product quickly and didn't try to pin the blame on Mr. Yokoi, but Yamauchi expected people to take responsibility for their mistakes. And I think that Mr. Yokoi felt this, and this is why he tried to make up for his failure on the Virtual Boy with another product. That product, by the way, ended up being the Game Boy Pocket. So, he made up for it.
Yeah, right before Pokemon, yeah.
Yeah. After that, Yokoi, who had put his retirement on hold, decided that it was time to take that off of hold. In August of 1996, he retired after 31 years with Nintendo.
Oh, he did retire before, okay.
But given its proximity to the Virtual Boy failure, a ton of media outlets accredited his retirement and the failure of the product to him leaving Nintendo. But the contrary, it wasn't like that. Literally, several times he was like, no, like, it was overdue. Like, I had stayed, like, several extra years than I wanted to. I just want to get out of here and work on my next thing. Mm. He remained silent about it in the media because he was already hard at work on his next adventure. Just as he planned, he started his own company a month after leaving Nintendo called Koto Laboratory. And he was joined by a longtime co-worker from R&D1, Yoshihiro Taki. And those two men worked on developing LCD keychain games. And they even made a small handheld console that ran off of one AA battery. And they sold it to Bandai. And it was known as the Wonder Swan. I don't know if you ever heard of that.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
it was only ever built in Japan, but it's pretty cool. It's like a one battery handheld system. So. Sadly, in 1997, after a small traffic accident outside of Tokyo, Yokoi was struck by another driver and killed as he was trying to leave his car to inspect the damage.
Yeah.
He was 56 years old.
Sad, man. So, I think that came up on our Tetris episode as well. Yeah.
Between the Virtual Boy, the retirement, and his death all in such proximity, everyone thought this was all tragically linked, but in this story, we're going to express the fact that he left Nintendo exactly when he wanted to, and he moved on to do exactly what he loved and what he did best, which is invent things.
That's good. So, I think people associate the failure of this console with, like, you know, it's easy to
absolutely
see that more as this like tragic kind of downfall. But he was fairly young. I mean, he wasn't even
absolutely 56, especially for a successful businessman.
Yeah,
Yokoi Gunpei was an incredibly talented and wildly experienced engineer who, over his lifetime, participated in creating some of the most iconic technology in gaming history. Literally,
like
without
the D-pad?
Him. Yeah. Literally without him, we would have no nostalgic memories of playing Game Boy in the car by the light of passing streetlights. Mm-hmm. So for that alone, thank you, Mr. Yokoi. I appreciate delivering that aesthetic to the world.
Yeah.
And your multitude of other incredible inventions.
And the Virtual Boy.
As for the Virtual Boy itself, well, its legacy is now, as we talked about for a moment there, a collector's item.
Yeah.
It's just one of those times that Nintendo tried and failed, and as a result, ended up creating this incredibly interesting artifact of gaming history.
Like the Power Glove.
Like the Power Glove.
I mean, it does make you appreciate it and respect like what it was going for in that era. And you still see its, you know, its legacy on and stuff like the Labo. Like, you know, there's and the 3DS, of course, like I mentioned earlier. But yeah,
what I get out of this is that this proves that Nintendo has, if not still or had, a ton of very fun-loving, good engineers that are willing to be invested in creating toys to entertain people. And this is just a situation where it just didn't work out the way they thought it would, because that's unfortunately not always how tech industry and gaming's work, you know, and or business in general. I would love to just have the Virtual Boy be exactly what he wanted it to be and be a fun toy and, you know, whatever, fall into history just as every other toy
It needed its Mario 64.
Yeah.
I mean, I think apparently in North America, they packaged the Mario Tennis with it's like they kind of went against their Mario thing, but it never really had a true like, you know, game that you associate with it. Like even some of the platforms that have fumbled the hardest throughout like our show, like it's like they still had this system seller, I guess you could say. Like it's but yeah, Virtual Boy never had that. I mean, all in all, there were like less than 24 games and.
Yeah, and I think a big part of that was the fact that once they realized things weren't working out the way they thought they would, they kind of bailed on it and pushed it out as this sort of gap filler. So they probably almost presumed it would end quickly. I'm sure they didn't guess as quick as it did, but I'm pretty sure they had they had ideas.
Yeah. People still emulate the stuff now. I think they've been able to render the colors a little differently. But yeah, it still has its place in history.
Yeah.
It absolutely does.
Yeah.
So there you go. It was a nice little hop on episode about the Virtual Boy.
No, it's cool. Like I said, a lot of this was completely new to me. Growing up a Nintendo kid, the Virtual Boy was always this sort of like this distant thing I was never able to touch for myself.
Yeah,
like,
and it still kind of is.
Yeah, that's true.
It's this not very
true. I got $200
thing.
I got to buy one right now.
That's I said. I can't keep looking at that stuff. I'll end up.
You think they have an HDMI adapter for the Virtual Boy? It's an inside joke. Randy bought an HDMI adapter for the GameCube.
Best money I ever spent.
Is it?
It looks so good. You know it does.
Does it? Austin, be honest. Does it?
It's an upscaler. It's not like a converter. Like, it's a true fucking... It is the best way to see that shit. And now we have this other little fucking USB thing we plug it into that, like, adds anti-aliasing and, like, depth of field shit so it can output in 4K.
I'm just gonna let rant on and try to justify it.
No, you're right.
You ain't seen Smash Brothers Melee till you see it in 4K.
That game looked like shit then, and it does now.
And that's not even true!
I know.
Do you think they'll ever kind of venture into anything?
Virtual Boy Classic?
Virtual Boy Classic.
Wow. Virtual Boy Classic.
No.
This time it'll actually be portable.
Batteries.
Here's the thing. If I worked at Nintendo, I could see a world where, like, you get into the VR game with Nintendo. Like, if they were like, we're going to compete with the PlayStation VR, and they just made the Virtual Boy 2, but it was just a headset. And it just looked like the Virtual Boy.
I mean, at least this made it to market, because, like, Sega tried to do one, too, and that got canceled, I think. Like,
yeah, I think they made arcade VR headsets, but they never actually pushed the home console. So, like, that's why Nintendo got to keep that first home console sort
like
of
moniker. Like, beachhead, like a...
No, it's like the... Like the movie First Kid.
Stop, bro. I don't... What is this movie?
We gotta watch First Kid.
No.
Alright, well, that's it.
The Virtual Boy, TM.
Much like
TM.
The real Virtual Boy, let this episode fall into the the random histories of Hot Button episodes.
I mean, yeah, like, and then be worth $200.
Part of the reason I'm still really glad we did this one. It's so cool because it's fucking Nintendo. Like, you know, like, it's, if this was any other, you know, random one-off game company that tried something this weird.
Yeah, it makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
I'm going to do an episode on the Novant Falcon. Remember that thing?
No.
Everybody
did the Phantom
out there,
come
everybody
out?
Everybody out there, Google the Novant Falcon. It's a ball controller that you hold the ball.
It's like the thing on South
it
Park.
Looks like it looks like a portal gun, kind of.
That's cool.
It was supposed to replace mice for PC gaming.
I'm working on an episode right now about a...
Failed handheld?
Yeah. So,
All right.
Not the Gizmondo, not yet. Still holding on to that one.
I'm working on a failed handheld episode myself. It's called the Xbox One.
Well, that's not a handheld gun.
It was if you plug your phone into a controller and use Xbox X Cloud. And then you can play Halo 5 with a lot of input lag. All right.
That's the way to play.
Yeah. All right. And much like the Virtual Boy, this episode peters out.
All right, throw up some plugs.
I'm gonna do the plugs, yeah. But I'm gonna change our website. We have a website. I'm gonna change it to Red Wireframe for the week this episode comes out only. That's not true. I'm not gonna do that. It's a lot of work for a bit. But just know I had that thought in this moment.
You could have just said you did it. So by the time this drops, like,
yeah, you missed it.
I already missed it.
This is gonna be a fun thumbnail to design.
If I don't look at it and get a headache, then,
exactly.
Yeah.
You guys are gonna wish I never got a copy of Photoshop. All right.
Get your 3D glasses.
Yeah, thanks for listening. We have a website, hotbuttoncast.com. There you can find links to our socials, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook at hotbuttoncast, and then a bunch of podcast feeds, our YouTube channel, things like that. However you want to consume this podcast. And if it's your first episode, we have
a lot.
At this point, I think like 70 other episodes or maybe even 69 other episodes. Nice.
Hey.
And the sex number.
If you like failed consoles, we've covered those too.
We've covered a couple of those as well. Yeah. But yeah, there's a search function. Just type a word in and let your mind close your eyes and just picture red wireframe and listen to our soothing, if not irritating, voices.
You know, well, I actually, a lot of the footage I've seen, I forget what the Virtual Boy sounded like. I bet it was great.
Probably bad.
Did it have headphones? Could you plug in headphones to it?
I don't know. Rate and review on iTunes and word of mouth. You like the show, you got a friend who likes video games, be like, hey,
put your head into a Virtual Boy.
Yeah, I know that COVID's going on, but let's go for a 2-hour car ride.
Yeah.
And then you kidnap them, and then you bring them cross country, and you listen to every Ahapan episode along the way.
Yeah,
and
we do not advocate kidnapping anybody, by the way.
Unless it gets us listens, dude.
Oh, yeah.
No,
you gotta be willing to.
Don't kidnap it, please. For the love of God, don't kidnap anybody.
Not even.
Unless. No. I think that's all the plugs. Did I miss anything? We should just end it there. That'd be great.
And they'll never know.
Yeah.
This is what we get for doing this on Mondays.
Yeah. Yeah, anyway, thanks for listening.
Yep.
Have fun. We'll be back in 2 weeks with a new episode.